And welcome back to Immersion Church. I'm Pastor Chris Solak. We are in week six of our study on 1 Timothy, today focusing on 1 Timothy 2, 8 through 15. This is dealing primarily with Paul correcting the false teachers, and I want to go very specifically into what he's actually correcting, because we're going to read a couple of different passages, different interpretations, different translations for 1 Timothy 2, 18 through 15, because we primarily use the Holman, the HCSB, and I'm going to be honest, I was shocked when I read this 7 to 8 verses of Scripture, how it read, and just the confusion over Paul's own ministry, Paul's own life, and the way the HCSB read. And the Lord brought correction and understanding, and I'm going to share that with you this morning. But we're going to go through a little text criticism, which is ironic that the Lord would have us do that in a week where Paul is actually correcting and giving Timothy the instruction for correcting the doctrinally incorrect teachings of the Church of Ephesus. And so it's just kind of interesting how things kind of lay on each other sometimes. And the Lord will illuminate and bring some of these things to light. And we're going to do that. And we're going to get in there in detail. I really want to first explain what the Church of Ephesus is going through. I know we talked about this a little bit in the very first week, and it's been many weeks since then. And so I just want to reiterate that the false teachings at Ephesus, which concerned Paul, arose from misreadings of the law of Moses, including false myths, including the patron goddess Artemis, and the genealogies, which were not consistent with the words of Jesus. The false teachers were also having wealthy women teach who were unapproved by the elders of the church. So there's a few different things happening. I think it's very important for us to understand that in the city of Ephesus was the Temple of Artemis. And the Temple of Artemis is one of the seven great wonders of the ancient world, the actual temple remaining today, there's not much left of it. There's very just some base pillars, and of course it was burned down several times. The last one actually from the Christian government in that time, and so it's just important for us to understand that this was keystone to the identity of the city of Ephesus. And that Artemis, or also the goddess Diana, depending if you were not in Turkey, but if you were in Rome, Asia Minor, it was the goddess Artemis in Rome, the goddess Diana. And to understand, this is one of the reasons that the wealthy women are being put up front, but the confused doctrines and genealogies are kind of the basis. And a lot of Christian scholars and secular scholars have conferred that these teachings were very similar to Gnostic teaching, which was taking polytheistic religion and intermixing it with Christianity and that of the words and the views of Jesus Christ, and mixing the genealogies. And the reason we get into the mixture of genealogies is to prove that there is actually a connection between Jesus Christ and what we would now call today a Gnostic or a polytheistic teaching. And so to really adding Jesus Christ to the pantheon of gods and goddesses. And so Paul is correcting this, but it would be to understand why would this be so pervasive was specifically within the Church of Ephesus has to do with the Temple of Artemis and being the patron goddess of the city of Ephesus. And so this was interwoven into the culture, and it also speaks to the fact of there would have been a cultural emphasis to bring women forward. And I just want to lay this foundation that this is what Paul is actually trying to correct, and he's trying to correct it. And it's very important that we go back to the very beginning of this teaching in week one, as we talked about a focus on love, faith, and good conscience, or the Christ consciousness. Okay? And looking at it from a spiritual perspective, Paul has been praying and warring, not just for the churches itself, but even the fallen teachers, that they would come to a realization of the false nature of their teaching, repent, and come back into relationship with Jesus. So there's many different layers of things going on here that have to do with love and intercession. Yet, I'm going to be honest, when we read the Holman, the HCSB interpretation of these scriptures and Paul's perspective on it, it triggered me. On a spiritual level, it triggered me in a way that I'm going to be honest, I haven't been triggered in a long, long time. It took me back to college when I used to take, I went to a Christian university in Southwest Michigan, and I had to take a religion class on text criticism. And I just want to lay out this first and foremost, that scripture is inherently 100% correct. Okay? No one is arguing that. Again, I always come back and reiterate that. But the fallibility is in how men interpret it. And based on the ministry and the life and the words and deeds of Paul, this interpretation of what he's expressing with this church, I find, I'm going to be honest, outlandish. Actually outlandish. And that I actually, the Lord recommended, I read it and I was like, I don't even know what to do with this. Which was ironic because I read it 3 months ago. It did not jump out at me at the time the same way it did the second time that I read it. And it was because the Lord was highlighting it, and he actually referenced another translation, and that translation fits perfectly with what Paul's ministry life indeed did. And you're going to see, we're going to cover it this morning, how wildly different they are. Like, I'm going to be honest, I don't see either one of these passages having much in common. There are certain things that are consistent themes, but for the reasons of saying this, and I'm going to speak to this before I even read out of the HCSB, that whoever deciphered this obviously had a very specific agenda in mind, and I don't see how it aligns with what Paul ultimately is communicating, what it has to do with the Church of Ephesus, and how they can even draw the parallel to the ministry of Christ, or the consistent nature of a creator God since creation. I'm going to try to tone my verbiage down from here, but it was astonishing to me, and I'm curious to see how you all react to it today as we go forward with it. So with all that being said, we're going to get right into the Word. Out of the Holman Christian Standard Bible, 1 Timothy 2:8-15. Therefore, I want the men in every place to pray, lifting up holy hands without anger or argument. Also, the women are to dress themselves in modest clothing with decency and good sense, not with elaborate hairstyles, golds, pearls, or expensive apparel, but with good works, as is proper for women who affirm that they worship God. Okay. Nothing crazy being said here, and this is very consistent with the other translation that we're going to read later. So that was the consistent part. Now we're going to actually kind of slip off the rails a little bit here. A woman should learn in silence with full submission. I do not allow a woman to teach or to have authority over a man. Instead, she is to be silent. For Adam was created first, then Eve. And Adam was not deceived, but the woman was deceived and transgressed. But she will be saved through childbearing if she continues in faith, love, holiness, with good judgment. Oh, dear Lord. Where do I start? Number one, we believe in equality in the spirit, and we're going to prove that this morning through the Word of God. That Adam and Eve, when they were created equal. Okay? And I think that it's really important for us to grasp that there is an equality in the spirit. Now, as far as purpose and calling are concerned, that can vary. And there is predisposition based on the hierarchy of the fallen reality, which is what the author in Paul is trying to speak to. And you're going to see as we read the other translation, how it actually relates to what Paul's trying to talk to here. But this interpretation, it slips off the rails really fast. And there's four areas that I want to speak to this morning very carefully. And because I wanted to stay consistent with the Holman Christian Standard. And I'm going to be honest, I read the Holman all the time. I have never encountered a passage like this in all. I've read the entire Bible front to back with the Holman Christian Standard Bible. Like I said, I read this 3 months ago. It did not become blaringly obvious to me in the moment, the way it struck me. So the Lord kind of saved and reserved, I know this for the time, to bring this message forward. So there are four concerning issues that I have with this passage. The first is inequality with women comes second because Eve came second. That has to do with the principle of the fall, and we still live in a fallen reality, and that has not changed. Men are to serve their wives, and wives are to serve their husbands. We know this. And so we can get into that hierarchy, but the Spirit has also brought a level of equality. And just hang in there with me for a minute. The second is that Paul restricts authority for women in the church, and according to this interpretation, completely silences them. We're going to read scripture here in a few minutes that after I get through these four points that speak to the counter argument of that. But that's not accurate to what Paul is actually speaking to. And someone has taken this and put an agenda behind it because Paul's deeds within the church of Rome, and very specifically, along with his travels and accounts and with consistent with the book of Acts, this is not how the early church regarded women as far as spiritual behavior and even leadership. And so this is actually more in line with modern perspective on restricting women in leadership. And in that, I find it very confused. I mean, we find it very confused. The statement, Adam was not deceived. If Adam wasn't deceived, then we would have actually had a clarity of line to preserve to preserve the holy line of Adam. And God would have had to deal with Eve accordingly, but Adam was deceived. Adam was self-deceived because he was culpable in the sin. To say that Adam was not deceived is ridiculous. Of course, he was driven out of the garden. Why? Because he sinned against God. That's self-deception. He saw that Eve did not die when the serpent deceived her. And then he became self-deceived, saying, oh, I'll take some of that. It didn't kill you like God said it would, which it was a spiritual death, not a physical death, which in all fairness, it was also a physical death because they were not mortal until that moment that they disobeyed God, that they sinned against God. So to say that Adam was not deceived would be self-deception in itself. And Paul, the apostle, filled with the presence of the Spirit of the Most High God, is not deceived in his correction of the church of Ephesus. I find it incredibly disrespectful to twist and warp the words of Paul in such a way. The fourth issue that I have concerning the way that this passage of scripture has been interpreted is that women will be saved through childbearing and not through Jesus Christ. This is an even more ridiculous notion that your value is in childbearing. That is a valuable trait as far as the human race is concerned. Absolutely, propagating the species. And God himself, Yahweh himself, go forth and multiply, right? That was the command coming out of the garden. But your salvation through childbearing, is that what Paul's really saying here? I'm going to give you one guess, and it's no. No. These are the things that we, Mark and I, have been increasingly concerned about. And God is giving us an example this morning to speak to it, to represent it. I really do hope that this doesn't offend anyone, even though sometimes the offense is necessary. But you're going to see where I'm going to go with this. So please bear with me if you're watching this. It's very important that we be correct. The Word of God is right, 100%. But we can be either correct or incorrect in the Word. We can interpret it correctly or incorrectly. And there's going to be people that are going to be in disagreement with the way I have interpreted this. But I'm going to tell you, I was incredibly troubled in the spirit when I read this. And I had to take it before the Lord. The Lord brought another perspective and correction to what I was actually seeing. I'm going to present that this morning. But I also talked with Mark. That was after I talked with Jesus. I called Mark, and Mark and I talked about the scripture. We looked at the scripture. This is not consistent with Paul's actions, motives, ministry, declarations, decrees, and the way he led. I wasn't there. I just have the evidence of what was done and how it was done. And we're comparing that to the statement that was just made. Wild. So I want to speak this morning to the counter to Paul's need to control women, which I think is incredibly wrong in the sense of how misrepresented what Paul is what he actually said and what has been interpreted and how it's used. Number one, we got to step back and talk about love, faith, and the Christ consciousness. This is more Luciferian. This is more world. This is a fallen system perspective, not that of Christ. I hope that you see that this morning. In Acts chapter 16, Paul appoints Phoebe, a woman, as a deacon of the Church of Rome and charges her to translate and deliver his letters. Well, that's confusing, since not only is she supposed to translate, but she's supposed to deliver. And a deacon, and we're going to get into what a deacon actually is according to the apostolic church, not the current church, but the apostolic church, even though they're similar functions, they're different based on denominations now. Denominations have different identifiers or attributes for what a deacon is and what a deacon isn't. But we're going to look at the apostolic. So the definition of a deacon, or deacons are model servants appointed. Very important that this word appointed is there. Appointed to a local church office, and they are deployed to assist the elders by protecting church unity, organizing practical service, and meeting tangible needs. This is what Paul appoints Phoebe for. She is made a deacon to carry out services within the Church of Rome and to translate and deliver his letters. And it gets better from there, and we're going to read it here in Romans 16, 1 through 2, how specific it is. But I, before we get past the deacon as a leadership position within the apostolic body of Christ, then we have to get apostolic definition for anointing. It simply means that you have been called, chosen, and appointed with one of the fivefold calling given to the church for the perfecting of the saints. All right. I hope you're tracking with me. Romans 16, 1 through 2. This is the HCSB. I commended to you our sister Phoebe, who is a servant of the church in Centuria, So you should welcome her in the Lord in a manner worthy of the saints and assist her in whatever matter she may require your help. For indeed, she has been a benefactor of many and of me also. Okay. So it's important for us to understand that I've commended to you our sister Phoebe. She is a servant, and that you should welcome her in the Lord in a manner worthy of the saints. Okay, now when he says that, he's speaking to the fact that she's coming in the authority of Paul. Now, there's going to be people who are going to try to disagree with that, but that's what he's saying. And that you should assist her with whatever she needs. That you should greet her in respect and show her the respect of someone who is coming in my authority. Number one, I think it's very important for us to understand when we come into the appointment of the apostolic church, that implies authority. That means that God's anointing is over that person for service, that they have a maturity and that they have been found worthy according to their mature spiritual nature. And this is very important for what we're going to read with what Paul actually spoke to Timothy, according to the church of Ephesus. We can also take the action from Acts 2:17. So I'll leave Phoebe there for a minute, speaking to the leadership role in the hierarchy of the church, the apostolic church, as it were. And I want to speak to this because this is actually a missed authority nestled into Acts 2:17. And this is very, very important because it's going to confirm Acts 21:7-9. And just hang in there with me. Acts 2:17, and the last days it shall be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Now, it's very important for you to understand, because prophecy is not only hearing from God, but being to declare over others. And it's very important that it say your sons and your daughters. Why? Because in the spirit, there is equality. I hope somebody said amen. I'll give you a minute if nobody did. Amen. For there is equality in spirit, one mind, one body, one spirit in the body of Christ. The world demeans, the world condemns, the world judges. But a loving Creator who created us in equality, connected in spirit, as we return to spirit, there is an equality once more, for we are all sons and daughters of the Most High, are we not? And I think it's very, very important for us to because if we are all not created equal in this way, then it diminishes the sufficiency of what Jesus Christ paid for. That's what we just read, unfortunately, from that passage. And you could say, oh, Pastor, you're taking it maybe a little too far. No, that's what it spoke to. And we're going to actually read what Paul truly meant. But I want to tie this understanding of authority through prophecy, because prophecy requires the Spirit, and Jesus, before he left in Acts chapter 1, had already told the early church to go and wait for the Holy Spirit to come, for you shall receive power, his authority to work in the earth. And I'm going to tell you, at Pentecost, there weren't just men in the room. You're going to have to reconcile that with God. But there were not just men in the room. And this is the evidence of that and the equality that comes from the Spirit of God. And this is what Paul is actually trying to combat with the church of Ephesus, is that there was an incorrect perspective, there was a usurping of what the Holy Spirit would do. And it had to do with the false doctrines and the worldly perspective of mishmashed Gnostic religion that was permeating the church of Ephesus at this time. So Acts 21:7-9 speaks to Paul on his way back to Jerusalem. When we completed our voyage from Tyre, we reached Ptolemais, where we were greeted the brothers and stayed with them one day. And then the next day we left and came to Caesarea, where we entered the house of Philip, the evangelist, who is one of the seven, and stayed with him. This man had four virgin daughters who prophesied. Okay, prophecy is the greater gift. Paul says it himself. Prophecy is the greater gift. This man has four single, instead of virgin, we can use the word single, but yes, they're virgins. But rather than focus on their virginity, they were single women who prophesied. God had given them authority to interpret from heaven what God wanted to speak. That these women were blessed and they had the gift of prophecy. Well, that's an authoritative gift. That's the greater gift. That's a gift of authority. Paul doesn't diminish them. Paul doesn't come after them. No. They minister to Paul. The reason they know they can prophesy is because they're ministering to those and to the Lord. This is the function of the apostolic church. This is one of the reasons that nominal religion does not want to accept the movement of Holy Spirit in an apostolic body. So I want to just declare this morning. Prophecy is an action of authority by the Holy Spirit demonstrating unity and equality with heaven. I want to say that again. Prophecy is an action of authority by the Holy Spirit demonstrating unity and equality with heaven. It's a greater gift because it's a gift of intimacy with God. It's one where we can come boldly into the throne of God that He would speak into circumstances and situations for the earth, for others, and even for ourselves. And most importantly, for the church. Paul said in itself that it's a greater gift for the building and uplifting of the body of Jesus Christ. And these four daughters are active participants in the body. Doesn't sound like Paul telling them to shut up and get in the corner now, does it? Because that's not what Paul was doing. And that's not what Paul was saying. And I hope as we read here, we're going to read out of the Passion Translation these same verses from 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 8 through 15. I hope that you hear what I've heard, what the Spirit shared with me in relationship to what Paul is actually trying to speak to the confused doctrines with mixed genealogies, with a Gnostic theme as wealthy women, and the reason that they were put forth was their wealth, without being appointed by the church to come in front to instruct anyone, not just men, anyone out of their own ignorance. There's a political statement to put wealthy, well-dressed people up front. It was about to influence them. It's about influencing them. And this is what Paul actually speaks to. So let's read. Therefore, I encourage the men to pray on every occasion with hands lifted to God in worship with clean hearts, free from the frustration of strife. Okay, that's consistent. I told you that these first parts weren't going to be so confusing. And that women would also pray with clean hearts, dressed appropriately and adorned modestly and sensibly. But why? Not flaunting their wealth. Okay, that's different, but they should be recognized instead by their beautiful deeds of kindness, suitable as one who worships God. He's talking about spiritual fruit now. He's talking about the evidence of, guess what? Love, faith, and Christ consciousness. That's what he's talking about with the women. Let the women who are new converts be willing to learn with all submission to their leaders and not speak out of turn. Oh, he actually said speak. I thought they were supposed to get in the corner and shut up. No, he just said speak out of turn. He didn't say not speak at all. And he said he's not saying to be submissive in such a way that you have no identity within the church. He says, as a new convert, to sit and listen until you've actually obtained the knowledge. We call that training. As a person who is training people apostolically, what did I have to do in my early moments with Christ? And I still do it. I had to do it building this message this morning. I had to get still and listen to what the Lord's instruction was for this word coming forth. And when the Lord's speaking, I don't interrupt. When the Lord's speaking through people, don't interrupt. But Paul's saying it's not that you don't ask questions. Just don't speak out of turn. This is a 180 degree shift in what we previously read and what we're reading right now. It's astonishing to me how different it is. And here he goes. I don't advocate that the newly converted women be the teachers in the church, assuming authority over the men, but to live in peace. Again, he's speaking to the fact of being trained. For God formed Adam first, then Eve. Uh-oh, here we go. Adam did not mislead Eve. Wait, I thought Adam was off the hook. He didn't do anything wrong. He's blameless, even though God kicked him out. Now, Adam did not mislead Eve, but Eve misled him and violated the command of God. He's speaking to this because it changed the hierarchy. They were equals, and because of that action, God moved man over woman. And the word is really specific to this. And so he's still speaking to this. But I love that he comes back to yet. So he explains. He speaks to as to why the hierarchy sits the way it does. Is because it violated the command of God. No confusion here, no ambiguity. Yet salvation, now listen to this. Yet salvation will come through a child born by a woman, and a woman will be saved by that child. Now we're talking about Jesus Christ. And women will be saved by that child if they continue in faith, love, holiness, self-control. And that we're speaking to the Christ consciousness, good conscience, which is the case for everyone, not just women, men as well. This is, to me, is just strange. It's strange, and you can see where these scriptures become weaponized, and it actually creates disunity within the body of Christ. This isn't accomplishing the will that God has for the functional body. So there's three points I want to take away this morning. First, we got to ask a question that has to do with the beginning statements here made. Why should we not flaunt wealth in the church. Why is Paul speaking to this as something that is unproductive and unnecessary? Well, equality of spirit. Looking at their kindness rather than their fleshly beauty. It's speaking to spiritual fruit. It's not speaking the carnal perspective, but that of the perspective of the spirit. That shouldn't be a surprise to any of us. My second point, Paul is not opposed to women teaching, and there's going to be people who disagree with that. There's going to be some people who disagree with that. Paul is not opposed to women teaching, but untrained, newly converted women teaching. You know, what's very interesting about the Passion Translation is directly taken out of the Hebrew and the Aramaic and the Greek. It's taken right from the translation of what was written on the parchment. And it's one of the reasons I love it. Now, we teach primarily out of the HCSB, which is more of a theological perspective on interpretive scripture. And the Lord has spoken to me. One of the reasons I'm such a fan personally is that Jesus has always spoken to me through the HCSB. When early on in my faith, like he would give me passages of scripture that I knew were scripture, but I would not know where to find them. And I would go into my phone and I would put the word Bible in the engine search and the words that he would give me. And they always came up in the HCSB. We do not throw the baby out with the bath water, so to speak. This passage is the only passage I've ever run into that has, I've had this, it's had this kind of effect on me. It was very disturbing because it so poorly represented what Paul was trying to do. Paul was trying to bring clarity to bad doctrine. And here's somebody reinterpreting a whole agenda that Paul isn't even speaking to. And you may or may not agree with that statement, but that's how the Lord communicated to me. And I saw it so very clearly. This danger of silencing the daughters of the Most High. No. The early church did not do this. We have the biblical evidence. We had women in a deacon role that were not just taking a leadership role in the church, but were actually going in Paul's authority to other convening bodies as his representative. That's an authoritative position. We have evidence, scriptural evidence of the early church and women prophesying openly within the body, authoritatively. Because Joel 2 spoke to the coming of the Holy Spirit, the weaponized age of Messiah, that in that time, God was going to pour out his spirit on all flesh, on the sons and the daughters, because within the spirit, there is complete and whole equality. Now, I can't speak to your purpose and your calling on your life. We've all been created and designed to fulfill a purpose that God has for us. And we all play different roles. What is God calling you to? My third and final point, and this one is not a shocker to anyone, but if you read these two passages, one deviates from the other. Salvation alone is found in the Messiah, Jesus Christ. Not in childbearing. You're not set free because of the child you popped out. No, what it's speaking to is the fact that the Messiah was born through the masterful plan of God and an intimate relationship. Same thing for John the Baptist as well as Jesus. That there's this wonderful relationship that the Holy Spirit brought life into two women that would usher in the greatest redemptive age this world will ever know. And that Mary and Elizabeth both had great intimacy with God through these experiences, and that God uses men and women alike through the power of His Holy Spirit, and we should never diminish His ability to do what He wants to do the way He wants to do it. And that He is the God of the impossible. But these are not impossible things that we were speaking to. These are declarations of the time that we have moved into and what the Messiah has paid for you and I. And in that, bringing correction to what Paul is speaking to. That there has to be sound perspective in doctrine according to the Holy Spirit. And that people have to be placed according, that appointment by anointing, we would call that appointment, is from a convening body of Spirit-filled elders that appoint that person according to the direction of the Holy Spirit. How many churches are functioning that way in this time? We do. We take it an extra step that once we have it confirmed amongst our convening body, that we actually have outside intercessors that confirm it as well before any decision is made. It's the desire to be correct in all that we say and do in our accountability to our Messiah, Jesus Christ. For it is His body, is it not? And that is what Paul is re-emphasizing. Not to diminish anyone, but to build unity, to reestablish and correct what is not of the Spirit, which was totally flesh, to bring it into unity in the Spirit for the purpose of unifying under Messiah and echoing His heart of love, faith, and good conscience. Let's pray. Jesus, I thank You for this message. Lord, it's troubling. It was troubling. It's still troubling. Lord, we have to look with spiritual eyes. We have to discern in the Spirit what is of You and what is not of You, and things that call themselves You that are misrepresented, Jesus. Lord, I ask for this message this morning to bring unity. That has been my prayer in preparation of giving this, is that we would respect, love, and care for one another. That would be our focus. And that those who want to be trained would be trained lovingly, respectfully, and authoritatively. We have all fallen short of the glory of God, and we have all been given the freedom by the blood of the Lamb and the power of the Holy Spirit. And we are all precious, equally precious in the eyes of our Creator, and that God can use each and every one of us according to His will and His good pleasure to bring about a result of heaven invading earth. Lord, I ask that You use our body and those who desire to serve You in spirit and in truth, that want to pursue You, want to be trained in the reality of who You are, in the holy words of Scripture, as well as in the power of the greater gifting of the Holy Spirit. That in that we would find unity and continual correction, that we would pursue You, and that You would speak to our hearts, speak to our minds, direct our paths, that we would know how to follow You in the day-to-day, and that when we see something that calls itself You, that it does not identify with Your plan, Your promise, Your church, that we would be able to openly identify it, Jesus. We pray for that discernment over our body. That discernment comes out of your love, Jesus, your love for us and the awareness of Holy Spirit. We thank you, Holy Spirit. Lord, strengthen us, build us up, and keep us laser focused on you, Jesus. And all God's people said, amen. Whew, heavy one, and detailed. I know this runs a little longer than we normally do. It sets up perfectly as we go into the beginning of chapter 3 next week, as Paul starts to talk about what qualifies us for church leadership. What is the qualifications that we must possess, and what must we demonstrate, and how are we reproved and then eventually appointed to lead within the body of Jesus Christ. Until next week, be blessed.